Make sure you guys hit the subscribe button if you guys are enjoying the content that we're throwing up. And make sure you guys hit the like button if you enjoy the video. And yeah, let's begin. Okay, so after what feels like 7 months, what feels like forever, we're finally getting into Uncanny X-Men by Matthew Rosenberg. Now, we covered the return of Cyclops, right? And I feel like we covered when Wolverine joined Cyclops, but in all honesty, in issue number 11 of Uncanny X-Men, there wasn't a whole lot doing there. Like, the big takeaway was, like, Cyclops got into a fight with basically the Purifiers led by Donald Pierce, and then, like, Wolverine showed up, rescued him, and then, like, that's where we are now. There were a couple instances where he kind of went around, but a lot of the characters that he visited, he basically visits again. So it's kind of cool. The way this sort of goes forward from like 12 all the way up to 16 is it really is in a lot of ways kind of self-contained. And that's why like when this picks up, you've literally just got like Wolverine tending to Cyclops, right? But for the most part, it's just them. Like, remember the whole events of Age of X-Men, which nobody's reading, that's all currently like taking place right now. So all the main X-Men are in an alternate reality. That's not a very good idea. And so the result of that is that basically in the Uncanny X-Men line by Matthew Rosenberg right now, all it does is really just leave us with like Wolverine and Cyclops. And of course, that's not much of an X-Men team. That's a team up. That's a Marvel 2-in-1 book. And so what we need is like a whole X-Men team kind of brought back together. And that's one of the things. One of the things to bear in mind when it comes to Cyclops and Wolverine is Cyclops relies on Wolverine a lot, and he has. Like, he's relied on him a lot over the years. And one of the things that he's picked up on is that there are still mutants that are out there that are not part of, you know, the Age of X event that have basically been like whisked off to another universe. They've all just been held captive or been taken or whatever the case is. And so what he basically does is essentially like, well, really like intimidated one of the guys from Office of National Emergency is really what it is. But the overall gist of this is that Wolverine just kind of like press gangs these guys in, and it's kind of like, you're going to get us into like this facility and you're going to help us rescue these X-Men. Now, this plan goes exactly the way you would expect, which is bad because Wolverine is not good at planning. Well, he's good at planning things, but only under certain circumstances, right? Like, Wolverine's good at planning things when it's just him. In this instance, it all just goes south. It all just goes belly up. Now, of course, this leads to like the arrival of what looks like ONE Sentinels, right? Now, the difference between Office of National Emergency Sentinels and like the Sentinels from Days of Future Past or like the classic Sentinels is that the Office of National Emergency Sentinels are piloted by men. And that serves two purposes. The first is that it allows a kind of judgment call so that, you know, a decision can be made on the spot, whereas Sentinels operate solely based on programming. And the second is to ensure that like Days of Future Past doesn't happen and the Sentinels don't become self-aware and like try to conquer humanity. But one of the things to notice is like as the X-Men are fighting them, those Sentinels are literally begging them to stop. Now, the X-Men, it really like Cyclops and Wolverine kind of ignore this because they know that the ONE Sentinels are piloted by men. So it's kind of like, hey, stop killing me. Please stop killing me. But then like once it all begins to kind of settle down, then once they basically like crack open one of the helmets, they basically end up realizing that like this is currently being piloted by Strong Guy. Now, Strong Guy is a character that we've never talked about. We've never talked about Guido. And he was kind of cool. Like he was like a gentle giant, right? I mean, he was a cool guy. Back in the day, Strong Guy was part of like the second iteration of X-Factor, right? Like the first iteration of X-Factor was the original X-Men, Cyclops, Angel, Iceman, Beast, and Jean Grey, who kind of formed like another team that was more of a complement to the X-Men as opposed to like a competitive team. And then once that Louise Simonson, Walter Simonson run ended, and that version of X-Factor was rolled back over into the X-Men, then you basically picked up with a newer iteration of the team. Now, Strong Guy's been around for a long time, and of course, as you would expect from his name, it's super strength. But what he basically says is like, they're experimenting on us here. We've been infected with a transmode virus, and they were trying to find a way to basically use us to interface with machinery and then like basically use us as a means to control the Sentinels, but we couldn't actually defy their programming. Now, the question becomes, what's the transmode virus? There's so many callbacks to old school X-Men stuff in the story. All right, those of you guys who have seen a character named Warlock, and you probably don't know his name, but you know what he looks like, where he looks like this really funky robotic looking thing. He's part of a group called the Technarchy. And the way this works is they basically, they're almost like the symbiotes to a degree, right? Like Venom, Carnage, that kind of thing. Where what the Technarchy do is they basically infect a being with a transmode virus. And what ends up happening is that virus basically drains that being of energy, and then all that's left is kind of a brittle husk. But if a person is not fully drained, they become a phalanx. It allows them to interface with technology, and then in turn, you know, they can be controlled by humans. And so once the remainder of the X-Men kind of break in there, of course, you find duplicates of Jimmy Madrox. You find like all these different iterations of characters out there. You find like Wolfsbane, Rain Sinclair. It's kind of a way for Matthew Rosenberg to say, hey, here's why you haven't heard from these characters for a long time. It's because they've been kept in a prison and they've basically been experimented on. So like Ileana Rasputin, she's much the same way. The sister of Colossus, also known as Magic, who basically wields like, you know, various forms of magic. magical energy and so on and so forth. But then you've also got Havoc, who's being held and is actually the means by which this entire system is being powered. Now, Havoc basically uses like a solar energy kind of thing, but basically he's like a giant battery more or less. It's kind of cool. But of course, the X-Men break in and more or less free everybody. And that's when things start to pop off. Of course, you basically have like the death of Strong Guy, a way for Rosenberg to kind of write him out. But of course, this basically leads to like the X-Men kind of taking up residence in a place called Harry's Bar, which is pretty illegit. I mean, basically they go from working in like this giant Xavier Institute with like all these secret passages and like technological triumphs and all this kind of cool stuff to like basically hiding out in a bar. But what they end up doing is saying, hey, look, you know, so far, like the X-Men as a team and me as Cyclops was more like militaristic and pretty hardcore back when I was running everything. But we're going to get back to our roots. We're going to focus on the way the things should be. Just because of the rest of the X-Men are gone does not mean we have to basically abandon our charter. I've made a list of all of our most dangerous enemies and we're going to face off against them. The first one is like Dark Beast. And you've got Mr. Sinister. You've got Cassandra Nova. You've got like Magneto. You've got Apocalypse. You've got the Shadow King on here. I mean, there's all kinds of like awesome groups. There's the MLF, the Mutant Liberation Front, which we'll actually see in this story. But again, these are all basically major villainous groups that have been part of the X-Men history for quite some time. The other cool thing about this is like Cyclops is kind of like, hey, if you don't want to be a part of this, you don't have to. We're not going to kill these guys. We're going to like capture them and basically hand them over to the authorities or what have you. Now, what they end up doing, of course, is finding a particular, like busting into one of the locations. And when they do, you know, they basically end up finding like all these little copies of Jimmy Madrox to a degree. It's kind of weird. What they're looking for, the person they're kind of hunting down here is Dark Beast, because he's the one that's experimenting on people. Now, Dark Beast is old school. Dark Beast is like mid-1990s Age of Apocalypse old school. So the way this played out in Marvel Comics is you had the Age of Apocalypse event, which most everybody's heard about. We've covered it kind of a little bit because it wasn't really that good of a story. But the overall gist of this was that Legion, the son of Charles Xavier, went into the past and his idea was to kill Magneto so that Xavier's dream of a peaceful coexistence between humans and mutants could basically come to fruition easier because Magneto wouldn't be there to get in the way. The result was that Xavier jumped in the way of the killing blow, and because Xavier never existed, the X-Men were never formed when they were formed. And so what that meant was that the villain Apocalypse conquered North America. Now, Magneto formed them later on, but it was a ragtag, you know, kind of ramshackle group. It was nowhere near as polished and capable as like the original X-Men were. Not to mention you had other satellite groups, like New Mutants was just kind of a satellite group that was out there. And so with that happening, the reality was starkly different in a lot of different ways. Like Cyclops was really more like, he was more dark. Wolverine had lost a hand. Like it was kind of wonky. But for Beast himself, he was very dark and sinister, and he was really like sadistic in terms of experimenting on people. And so what that meant was that when the Age of Apocalypse ended and that reality basically was more or less destroyed, that Dark Beast alongside X-Man Nate Grey and a handful of others, they escaped into the main Marvel universe. With the X-Men showing up here, basically Dark Beast, where he was previously killed, he was more or less resurrected by Mr. Sinister and then given like all kinds of like technological advancements and so on and so forth. And that's where all this kind of comes to fruition, where he shows up and he would have no problem killing all of the X-Men. He basically shows that like he's got all these technological advancements and like this big, you know, bionic body and all kinds of crazy stuff. But what it means is that he is for the most part highly durable against the X-Men. Now, of course, this does not speak to adamantium. Adamantium being the most durable metal in the world, alongside Ilyana Rasputin's ability to like use magic to teleport and so on and so forth. It all means that Dark Beast is taken down pretty quickly, right? I mean, it's not a super long drawn out conflict. And so, of course, when that happens, he's basically taken captive by the X-Men. And so the question they have is, what do we do with this guy? Well, the result is that they can't kill him. They need him. They have to use him for the purpose of like figuring out what's going on with all these experiments and locating all these other mutants who are surrounded in like all these little camps and so on and so forth that are kind of spread everywhere, right? Because with Dark Beast, that's one of the things that he focused on. He never put all his eggs in one basket. But in order to basically keep his life preserved and to kind of work alongside the X-Men, what he does is offer the location of the Marauders. And so basically this is kind of like, hey, you know, the Marauders are in different places. I don't know exactly where they're all at, but all you have to do is find one and then everything will be okay. And so what they basically do is they end up tracking down a guy named Reaper. Now, this is where the other part of the equation begins to come in, because what the X-Men are also looking for is a Mutant Liberation Front. But the idea here is that Reaper was originally part of the MLF. Now, the Mutant Liberation Front was a group that was originally formed by Strife, and it was like a radical group. They were really kind of designed to be the antithesis to what was essentially like the later stage of New Mutants going into like X-Force as it was created by Cable. Think of them as something akin to like the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, but a little more extreme sometimes. But Reaper was part of their ranks for a time, and originally Pontius Xanadu had the ability to create these sort of waves that would almost kind of slow down time or slow down people's reactions, and he could adapt his arms to become various, you know, weapons and things like that. All that really came to an end during All-New X-Factor Volume 2, I think it was, when Terrence Hoffman basically took away his powers to try to make himself powerful. But the overall gist of this is that he's basically depowered now, but he still does to some degree have connections with the Mutant Liberation Front, because what Hope Summers has been doing has basically been trying to reform the team. Well, what better way to do that than to reach out to old members? And so that's when the X-Men essentially track him down and say, hey, look, somewhere along the line, Hope tried to reach out to him and bring him into the team. He said no, but she gave him a burner phone, and so she'll try to make contact again, and when that happens, we'll use him as a spy. Now, around that same time, Cyclops, of course, is meeting with Valerie Cooper. So again, a lot of things going on here. Valerie Cooper, of course, was a one-time liaison between the government-sanctioned X-Factor team with Strong Guy and, like, the U.S. government. But because of the fact that Valerie Cooper was kind of introduced in that capacity, her role as like, the National Security Advisor, different things like that, or I think it was, like, the Special Assistant to the President or whatever it was, that basically led to her having a huge hand with regards to, like, the government's interaction with mutants. And so Cyclops is well-established in having had dealings with her, with her having been part of, like, the Office of National Emergency, different things like that. You know, it's one of these scenarios where, at the same time, of course, the rest of the X-Men, like Cyclops, rejoins them. They go looking for the Marauders. They end up finding Scrambler, who's basically a person who can send people's mutant powers into overdrive to a degree, or kind of scramble them. But once the X-Men basically try to chase after him, and of course he makes his escape, that's when they're met with the arrival of Callisto. God, there's so much that happens in this. Now, this is one of the reasons why I love this story, is because there's so much to explain. So Callisto is leader of a group called the Morlocks, and the Morlocks were a group that basically resided underground. Now, Callisto was leader of the Morlocks for some time, and they stayed in the sewers of New York because their physical mutations basically made them appear in such a way to where they couldn't live on the surface. Eventually, Callisto is ousted by Storm, and Storm takes over leadership of the Morlocks, and, like, Callisto is basically a steward. She basically runs the Morlocks while Storm is away. And so with Callisto kind of showing up here, it's like, hey, look, the Morlocks have basically been, like, massacred again by the Marauders, is more or less what's happened. But that's when we also kind of run into the return of Chamber. Now, Jonathan Starsmore he's old school, right? Like, and he was a Generation X character. So the way this played out in Marvel is, of course, you had the original X-Men by Stan Lee and Jack Kirby, and then because of their success with, like, Giant Size X-Men number one and so on and so forth, and, like, going into, like, eventually X-Factor, in between those two teams, you had the New Mutants, which was basically Marvel's attempt to kind of redo the idea of, like, a younger X-Men team. But because of that, what Marvel did following the success of New Mutants and the success of X-Factor is they said, well, let's introduce, like, a fourth iteration in the form of Generation X. And it was basically New Mutants all over again, but it was taught by Emma Frost instead of Charles Xavier, and it was basically tapping into, like, the younger demographic, kids from, like, the 1990s. And it was hugely popular. But Jonna was one of these characters where he's basically walking, talking, living psionic energy. When his powers first popped up, it blew a hole in his mouth and his chest, and that's why he has all that energy radiating from him. And so when he speaks, it's kind of like in this weird ethereal tone, more or less, but he's been with the Morlocks for quite some time, and it kind of makes sense because of how he looks. This leads to, like, the rest of the X-Men essentially, like, giving a home to the Marauders by basically dropping them off in this country. Of course, Valerie Cooper kind of set it all up, but it's like, hey, look, there's these rebels in this European nation. Go there, topple the rebels, we'll give sanction to the Marauders. So basically, like, gives them a new home, more or less, outside the United States. Which, one of the big things that's kind of happened here is the actions of Cyclops have been very high profile, right? Like, there's been very little regard to, like, discretion. And what this does is it brings in Captain America. Now, Steve Rogers is not here for the purpose of, like, picking a fight. It's just one of these things where Rogers is kind of like, hey, look, man, the world sucks for mutants right now. As the Avengers, we can only do so much, but we literally live and die by, like, public opinion, right? So I cannot be seen talking to you, but if you ever need me, here's an Avengers card. There's secret ways to get a hold of me. So I guess it's kind of like, hey, look, we support mutants, but only on the lowdown, right? Like, only, like, hush, hush. But this leads to a confrontation between, like, the Mutant Liberation Front and basically, like, the X-Men. And again, like, the fight that you see here is pretty tame, but with Hope Summers, she's literally kind of taking on the stance of, like, classic Cyclops, where she's like, it doesn't matter what we do so long as we basically change the minds of humanity, right? Like, we'll do it by any means necessary. Now, the other half of this is, remember, Hope Summers can duplicate powers. And so where she literally fires off a shot, hits Cyclops in the eye, and then Wolverine goes to attack her, she blasts off Wolverine using the optic beams of Cyclops. But Hope Summers was always kind of a one-man army, sort of a Swiss army knife of like the mutant world. But again, the problem with her character is that she was rising to prominence and stories were being told about her at the time that Marvel was winding down and going into Secret Wars. So nothing ever came of her. And so, you know, in a hurry, the MLF is basically rounded up, handed over Captain America, and they're basically taken prisoner. And that's when Cyclops kind of has this big conversation where he talks directly with Alex, with his brother Havoc. And Havoc basically says, hey, look, man, I know that you're leading the X-Men trying to do the right thing, but here's the problem. You have a history of being militaristic. What guarantees can you give us that you will not go back back to being that way again. And the result is that Cyclops kind of thinks about it for a minute and says, yeah, you're right. We're basically with people here who have led various iterations of X-Men teams, right? Like, you've got Multiple Man, Jimmy Madrox. You've got Wolverine, who led his own X-Men team. You've got Danny Moonstar, who led New Mutants. You've got Havoc, who led led X-Factor for a little bit of a time. And so the stance of Cyclops is, I'm not the only one here qualified to lead. So I'm stepping down and we'll appoint somebody else to take my place. And it's actually a smart move. It's kind of returning the X-Men back to the way they were before. This also leads to the arrival of Magneto kind of showing up with his brotherhood and, like, you know, attacking like this human base. There's so much that gets crammed in to these like 6 or 7 issues. Honestly, I kind of think it's a little much, but this brotherhood is like not really the classic brotherhood, but the most popular version that most people know from like X-Men, the animated series, including a couple of the things. You've got Avalanche, who basically manipulates tectonic plates, Pyro, who can manipulate fire, but he cannot create it. And then you've got Juggernaut, who's kind of a new addition, but that's when we end up finding out he's not actually Magneto. Instead, he's a guy named Joseph. Now, Joseph is Joseph. Matthew Rosenberg, why did you bring back Joseph? So back in 1995, in the story If Sins Be Forgiven, Scott Lodell had this genius idea. We're going to create a clone of Magneto. Why? Well, because there was this girl named Astra, who was originally like one of the original recruits from the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, which we didn't know. It was something that basically Scott Lodell kind of made up at the time. And Magneto treated her terribly. And so in order to get revenge... when the satellite Avalon was destroyed and Magneto crash landed on Earth, Astra took his body. It doesn't matter who Astra is. She took his body into this place between dimensions, healed his mind, and then like cloned him and did it like just to get revenge on Magneto. Like, she was just mad, and it was dumb. Now, Joseph eventually became cool, but like, it was kind of a dumb idea in terms of its original creation. I never really understood why it was done that way. In order to explain Joseph effectively, it would take like 30 minutes. Like, it would take a video unto itself. It was one of those weird decisions by Marvel. Basically, it's revealed this is not actually Magneto. This is his clone, Joseph, who for some reason has made his return. And then when Juggernaut realizes that he was lied to, he basically turns on Joseph, defeats him, and then suddenly like Betsy Braddock comes out of nowhere, basically like Quanon, which is a weird thing in and of itself. And that of course leads to like Joseph is killed by essentially like Psylocke, or at least Quanon, and then essentially the story ends. Okay, here, we can't end it that way. God, Matthew Rosenberg, I don't understand why he crammed so much stuff into this. Okay, so Marvel had this story called The Fall of Mutants. And it was basically this event where like the main Marvel X-Men were believed to have died. And so what ended up happening was like Betsy Braddock, Psylocke, basically like washed up on the shore in Japan. She was taken by Natsuo, I think it was, the leader of the Hand, and a mind swap was performed between Betsy Braddock and this Japanese chick named Quanon. And what it essentially meant was that Betsy's mind was in the body of Quanon and Quanon's mind was in the body of Betsy. The issue with this was that Quanon essentially died, which meant that like Betsy Braddock just ran around for a long time as a Japanese assassin. It was a way for Marvel to just kind of like swap races, to kind of like race bend a character, which is interesting because nobody really seems to complain about that. They only complain about Sam Wilson and Captain America. So I guess, you know, selective outrage. It was a weird time in Marvel Comics, but basically Psylocke's back is essentially what this, or at least Quanon's back. We don't really know. You have to read the next story arc in order to find out. I love Matthew Rosenberg's writing, but like way too much is crammed into like the latter half of the story, right? It's just like, bring everything back, and then it all gets dumped. And like, honestly, this should have been stretched out over the course of like 3 story arcs. It would have made it a lot easier to digest because everything moves so fast, and it's just kind of like, you don't have time to catch your breath. I don't know. Let me know what you guys think down in the comment section. Anyway, if you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button in order to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all later. Peace.